Hi guys, and welcome back to On The Shelf. So if you didn't understand the intro, it's a little kind of inside joke, I suppose, from my previous video. If you haven't seen that, then I'll leave a link for you to go and check that out. To say the least, it had a very kind of hit and miss response with some people in the community. Some people really got on board with what I had to say, and there was a really nice discussion that went on. Some of you know really took what I had to say out of context and spun it to sort of fit your own agenda, which I don't really appreciate. But I just want to say thanks to everyone who kind of got on board with that video, who got on board with the conversation, and you know, to everyone who sort of made a follow-up video or, you know, to continue the conversation, you know, thanks for that as well. I really appreciate it. So, you know, getting back to what we actually all really love, which is manga. You know, that's what's important, that's why we're here, that's why I make these videos, that's presumably why you're watching this video right now. Here is another video in the Genius Of series, and it focuses on a really, really special mangaka that I have recently become obsessed with. He's really, really different, he's really out there, and I'm pretty sure all of you will have heard of him in some shape or form in the past, and that is Taiyo Matsumoto. So yeah, without further ado, let's get straight to it. So to start off, I just want to sort of give a little bit of background as to how I discovered Taiyo Matsumoto. Pretty late last year, there was a release by Viz Media, which we're going to talk about very soon, called Cats of the Louvre. And when this was released, it was something that immediately caught my eye, not necessarily for, you know, the art style or the story in particular, but the actual cover. So yeah, this is 100% was a cover buy, and I'm really glad that I did pick it up initially. So Cats of the Louvre by Taiyo Matsumoto was released by Viz Media. I believe it's like two volumes in one. Now, what immediately caught my eye was just the design format of it, I guess. It has like a glossy finish on the top, and then the bottom is like this matte kind of canvas almost, and it goes all the way around the spine and the reverse of the book, and it makes it actually look like a canvas, a painting canvas. So if you followed this channel for a while, you'll know that this is probably one of my favorite reads of last year. It was definitely my favorite cover of last year. And it became this series that really sort of opened my eyes to the genius of Taiyo Matsumoto, how wonderful he is, how, you know, unique his art style and his storytelling can be. And I'm not going to go into too much depth about Cats of the Louvre. I'll give a quick overview, but there is a full review of the series that I did. I'll leave a link somewhere and you can go and check that out if you like. So Cats of the Louvre follows, as you'd imagine, these cats that live in the infamous art gallery in France. They're all stray cats, they all have very unique personalities, and they're all looked after by the janitor of the art gallery. He keeps them in secret in this loft and, you know, feeds them wherever possible. Now, one of the cats is a relatively young kitten known as Snow Bebe. I promise I'm not just saying that weird, it is written in this French style. But Snow Bebe is basically spotted in amongst the art gallery, and then it becomes this huge thing of that there are cats living in the Louvre and someone is trying to find them and presumably get rid of them and throw them out on the street. Where the magic of this series really shines is that Snow Bebe has this unique ability, and he can actually like travel into the paintings, and this becomes integral to the story. I won't spoil it too much, but the janitor is on a journey to discover something, and Snow Bebe really helps in that conquest. Now, I've said it before and I'll say it again, what I really, really love about this series is the cats all take on these kind of alter egos when they are amongst themselves. And Taiyo Matsumoto is fantastic at storytelling, in particular in this series, because the way that he draws the cats when the humans perceive them differs greatly when they're communicating amongst each other. So you have the kind of big boss cat who's got a scar on his face, and you see him and he just looks like any old cat. But when the cats are actually discussing things amongst themselves in these like private conversations, they become personified, and the cat actually has a cute little jumper, and he looks like sort of every stereotypical big boss that you've ever seen in anime or manga. So yeah, the series kind of deals with these like internal politics amongst the cats, and some of them really like Snowbebe and some of them really hate him. And you know, you want to find out more about him and why he's so mysterious, why he has this ability, and it flits between that and the human's perception of the cats. And it's just really beautiful because I think a story that's set in an art gallery, which has such unique art and also such differing art between the human side of things and the cat side of things, just makes it, you know, really fantastic and really kind of unique. And I suppose that's like one of the main takeaways from this video, is that Taiyo Matsumoto's art style is one of the most unique things you will ever read in manga. It's immediately noticeable in amongst any other kind of art style. You just spot it from a mile away. And some people it really resonates with, and others it definitely rubs the wrong way a little bit. Like, I know so many people that have tried to read Taiyo Matsumoto and couldn't because they're put off by his art style, or you know, his stories are a little bit slow sometimes. And that's the thing, Cats of the Louvre isn't really this action heavy battle shonen that some of you are used to. It's a much slower kind of slice of life story, but it has such a beautiful kind of overarching theme to it, and you know, just a really unique take on storytelling that it's just so worth your time. And of course, with this beautiful release by Viz Media, which is particularly cheap considering the quality of it, it's just definitely worth picking up and checking out. And it's just something that is so self-contained that you can just binge through in a really short amount of time, and I promise that you will have not read anything like this before. So of course, much like everything in manga collecting, when you finish one series by an author that you really love, you're obviously going to go and seek out more content from that creator. And my good friend Zach from Mutu Shelf, his favourite mangaka is Taiyo Matsumoto, but his favourite manga, which he always talks about, is Tekken Kinkreet. Now, Tekken Kinkreet is also released by Viz Media. You can get it in this really nice all-in-one. It's huge, like it's a really kind of tall book, but it is printed left to right, so it's read in a more kind of traditional comic book sense, but please don't let that put you off. So Tekken Kinkreet, it's something that most of you will probably have heard of. It was released as a really, really great anime film back in the day, which I watched very early on in my anime collecting hobby, but it's something that I forgot about. I watched it once or maybe twice, and then I kind of put it on the shelf, no pun intended, and sort of completely forgot about it. It fell by the wayside, and I think that's just, you know, a criminal thing to do, to be honest, because this is probably, it's definitely my favorite Taiyo Matsumoto story that I've read, but it's probably one of the best manga that I've read this year, if not, you know, in my entire collecting sort of career, if you like. Okay, the reason I feel that way is because it starts off with kind of like typical tropes of sort of action style series. You know, you've got this kind of steampunk vibe. It gave me like really cool kind of downtown Tokyo Akira type vibes. It's set in this fictional town that's sort of the playground of these two young orphans known as Black and White. We're not sure if they're related, we're not sure if they're siblings or whatever, but they kind of help each other in this journey to surviving this town and all the things that, all the horrible things that happen to them. You know, there's Yakuza and there's like dirty cops and there's sort of corruption everywhere, and they literally scavenge to survive. They turn to crime and they, you know, mug people and they commit heinous acts of violence, but it's got a very kind of sweet undertone to it about friendship and brotherhood, I suppose, and kind of finding your family wherever that may be. Now, I've not read a manga like this since, I guess, Cats of the Louvre, that I really sort of, you know, devoured in one or two sittings, because it is, again, very self-contained and really easily accessible, but also because the story is just so compelling. So you have, you know, Black, who is this kind of really rash and devious character who will do anything to survive and do whatever possible. White, on the other side, you know, who's aptly named, is kind of, he's not innocent, but he is much more childlike in his demeanor, the way that he talks, everything that he perceives is from a child's perspective. And I guess it's kind of Matsumoto's way of saying, you know, this is almost the way that a child should perceive the world. And then you have Black, who has a much more pessimistic outlook, and that's because of what society and the world have done to him. The story kind of of follows their adventures alongside this Yakuza group who have recently journeyed to the town and have decided that they're going to take it over and take it for themselves. And Black is having none of this because he believes that the town is his and he will do whatever he can to keep the town under his control. So of course the law get involved at some point and things definitely take a turn for the worse for the two kids. What I really love about this series is obviously, again, the unique art style, the way that they travel through the city is a really unique vibe, and it's just got such a really cool kind of steampunk feel to it that I really love. But then also, just the underlying tones of like brotherhood really carried it. It made it such a heartfelt story. And alongside all of this, you know, horrible stuff that happens to them, their bond never really kind of disintegrates, and they are always, you know, thinking about one another and wishing the other the best. And that's really what it's about. It's about this camaraderie, about this brotherhood that they both have for each other and how they help each other to survive the world and all of the, you know, turmoil that it provides. So I definitely recommend checking out Tekken Kinkri. It is definitely one of the best reads that I've read of 2020 so far, and it does have a really, really, you know, special place within my collection amongst some of the best manga that I've ever read. I also think it's important to mention that if you've read Cats of the Louvre and you didn't really enjoy the slow kind of pacing of that, that Tekken Kinkri definitely steps it up a notch. There's a lot more action in this, there's a lot more fighting and violence in this. You know, there's just a real different vibe to it, and even though Matsumoto's art style is unique, it is noticeably different in Tekken Kinkri. I think everything has a softer tone to it in Cats of the Louvre, and in Tekken Kinkri it's much more rough around the edges. Some of the characters are much more emotive and I suppose caricatured in a way to make them seem over the top and very sinister. So you immediately know who the enemies are and you immediately know who the kind of good guys are. But just the overall art style and, you know, the message of the story is just such a great one, so I wholly recommend you checking it out. I also think it's really important to mention that Taiyo Matsumoto himself was an orphan, so you can really kind of add that extra layer to the story. All of his stories seem to have this kind of need for family and this, you know, overarching kind of story of family is really wherever you find it. The cats and Cats of the Louvre all are stray cats, but they formed this little family amongst themselves and they're perfectly happy, even though, you know, in normal circumstances they may not have necessarily met one another. And of course Tekken Kinkri is all about these two boys who we aren't ever told if they are actually blood related. Matsumoto again tells this really, really great story about two young boys who under normal circumstances would never have known one another, but the bond that they have is so strong that it literally takes over their entire lives. So both of them are just really kind of a beautiful story that I think the author really had the need to tell about maybe just some of the things in his life that he wished had gone differently. And again, when you look at Black and White stories, Black really kind of goes down this negative path, and perhaps he felt that if not given some of the opportunities that he was given, that would have been very possible for him as well. Okay, the next pickup that I got from Taiyo Matsumoto is the latest release by Viz Media, and that is Ping Pong. So I only have volume 1 so far because volume 2 is yet to be released as of this video, so perhaps I will do a further review of the entirety of the series later. More than likely I will just post probably about it on Twitter or Instagram or something. Again, another fantastic release by Viz Media. It has this all over kind of manga print of some of the panels of the manga, but with this really nice like blue glossy kind of finish over the front. It's very similar to a lot of their signature editions. So if you've got kind of like the newer volumes of 20th Century Boys or Monster or Goodnight Pompon, it's very like that. But it has a little bit of a harder kind of finish to the front cover. Now this is a weird one because it's very different again to the previous two stories. As you can imagine, it's all about ping pong. It's all about these two boys who are childhood friends. Again, it follows this sort of overarching camaraderie kind of theme that he likes to tell in his stories. But this one is a sports manga, like through and through. And I've never really dived into sports manga. It's something that I never bothered with. And I probably wouldn't have bothered with it if I hadn't have read the other Taiyo Matsumoto works. So that's not to say you shouldn't check it out. because I definitely, obviously recommend it. We have these two boys known as Smile and Pico. So Smile is probably the main protagonist of the story. He's nicknamed Smile because he never smiles. He's kind of this emotionless, kind of miserable child who, you know, is good at ping pong, but, you know, he doesn't really get on with other children. And then on the other hand, you have Pico, who's this really outgoing, loud and obnoxious child, who's also sort of a ping pong prodigy in his own right, or at least he's the best in amongst his friends. So the difference between the two children is that Pico, you know, really wants to be a ping pong champion, and that's all he's ever wanted, and Smile couldn't really care less. As you can imagine, the story kind of goes down the route that Smile is actually a much better ping pong player, and he is much more sort of just gifted in general. He doesn't really have to try to be good at ping pong, he just is good. But his attitude and his outlook on life is what really hinders him, because he doesn't really care about ping pong all that much. He doesn't really seem to care about anything. And winning or losing never really kind of computes with him. He doesn't care either way. So in a typical kind of shonen fashion, I guess, you've got these kind of tournaments and these goals, these overarching events that happen in the manga, and how these characters sort of progress through those really shapes them into what they're going to become in adulthood. It felt a little bit like the initial chapters of Haikyuu, I guess, not quite as shonen, but just this sort of, we'll start at bare bones, we'll start them at the very bottom, and we'll outline all of the adversaries that they've got to overcome, and everything that falls in between is really sort of put there to develop these characters for our enjoyment. But again, I think what really shines with this is the way that Taiyo Matsumoto draws ping pong. There's a lot of very well thought out panels in this. There's a lot of really great action shots, and you can really kind of feel the game coming to life as you read it. I know a lot of people that have tried to read this and disliked it immediately, maybe just because they thought it was particularly boring. And for some, I guess, sports manga can be boring, but then I think that this is more than a sports manga. It's again, it's about this kind of like friendship, this brotherhood. The characters are so real and interesting that I just really, really enjoy finding out more about them. I want to know why kind of Smile has this outlook on life. I'm looking forward to the way that Pico kind of deals with the fact that his friend is better than him and he might actually achieve the dream that he always wanted. And as well, I think for someone who's not a ping pong fan or a sports fan at all, this really stood out to me because it was something that I couldn't put down irregardless of the subject matter. I think just the way that it's drawn is so masterful and so well crafted that anyone can enjoy this regardless of whether you like sports or not. Like all of Matsumoto's manga as well, there's a really, really great host of side characters in Ping Pong, and there's some really great kind of other students that we find out more about and their kind of motives for becoming ping pong champions. And going back to, you know, his other works, I think he has this great way of making characters feel really unique. In Cats of the Louvre, all of the cats have their own personalities and their own outlooks and their own motives. And again, in Tekken Kinkri, you find out a lot about the Yakuza and why they're doing the sinister things that they do, and, you know, some of the big bosses or the, you know, the villains in the story and everything that goes in between. He's just so great at making characters feel so real and so fleshed out, that nothing feels kind of half-baked. So those three are the only series so far that I have read by Taiyo Matsumoto. There are also some others out there that I really want to check out. There's a series called Sunny, which I think is about orphans again, but I've heard that that can be quite a harrowing tale, so I'm thinking of picking that up later and sort of shelving it just to read on a kind of a day where I feel up to it, because he does pull at the heartstrings. He has a very, very good way of making you attached to these characters and making you feel, you know, emotionally invested. So I definitely need time to build up to that one. There's also one that's called Go Go Monster, which was released by Viz Media. I found that it existed when doing some research online, and it looks absolutely beautiful. It came in this kind of, I don't know if it was hardcover or if it came in like a box set almost, but it just looked fantastic. Unfortunately, that's out of print, the cheapest that I could find it for was like £70 or something like that, which I'm not willing to pay for a second-hand single volume of manga. I think it's like an omnibus style, but it's still, you know, way out of my budget, and I don't plan on kind of picking that up unless Viz do a reprint, which I'm really, really hoping for if these sell well. And of course, I'm really looking forward to reading the rest of Ping Pong. Now, this video would not be complete without a little say from my friend Zach from Uchu Shelf, because he's been kind of, you know, championing Taiyo Matsumoto for years. Like, he owns lots of his works in French because he's imported them because we don't have them. He bought Ping Pong in French before it got an English release because he'd waited so long for it to get licensed that he just decided he was going to try and learn French to read it. Like, he is the most hardcore Matsumoto fan that I've ever met. So of course I asked him to hop onto this video really quick just to give us a little bit of an overview of why he loves Matsumoto so much and why you should be checking him out.
Hey folks, it's Zach from Uchu Shelf here. I want to talk to you guys today about Taiyo Matsumoto, my number one all-time favorite mangaka. Of the hundreds upon hundreds of manga that I've read in my almost two decades of being a manga fan, I have been motivated, entertained, and moved to tears by so many of the stories that I have read. But no manga from any creator has ever so successfully monopolized my complete and total undivided attention than that of the works of Taiyo Matsumoto. Now, to me, the things that make manga great are its stories. Regardless of the origin of stories and comics throughout the world, when it comes to manga, these stories are so unmatched and unlike anything you'll find anywhere else on the planet. There's something about the stories in manga that, when blended with unmistakable, easy-to-recognize art, makes manga itself just wholly unique. And with there being this diverse ecosystem of so many different art styles in the world of manga and anime, very few mangaka have a style that you could pick out of a crowd with absolute precision. Especially when it comes to the works of Taiyo Matsumoto, he definitely has his own style that you can recognize and pick apart from any other manga and anime. Now, from science fiction worlds rooted in multiculturalism to orphanages, the streets of changing towns through world-renowned art museums, Taiyo Matsumoto's stories have captivated me in a way that I never knew any entertainment medium could. His manga takes us through the multitude of stories told through the eyes of cats, children, and the like. And his works explore themes that are really important to me, such as abandonment, finding a place to call home, and seeking refuge in the few flickers of light that the sun can slip past the clouds. Now, when it comes to media, whether it's anime, manga, TV shows, movies, video games, whatever, I kind of go through different phases of what I really am into, what I'm really enjoying at the time. But when it comes to Taiyo Matsumoto, ever since I discovered him in 2004, it has been a non-stop consistent line of just me enjoying his works over and over again. Now, I say I have an obsession with Taiyo Matsumoto because I actually got in trouble going to buy one of his manga. So in high school, we went on this big field trip to Toronto, and I knew there was a big manga shop that I wanted to go to and check out, but we had a very clear itinerary of what we were supposed to do that day, a very clear system of who we were supposed to be with, where we were supposed to check in, and things like that. And instead of doing that, I took an hour and a half to go out of my way to find this comic shop. I got lost. I pretty much didn't do the field trip at all. Bought myself the 3-in-1 omnibus of Tech on Kinkreed. Tried to sneak back into the field trip and then got, I think it was 2 weeks of detention. I had to stay after school for like an hour and a half. I didn't get any lunch breaks. It was worth it. It was definitely worth it, but would I do it again? Definitely. Taiyo Matsumoto's manga doesn't just entertain me, it inspires me on a level that no other entertainment medium does. It inspires my outlook on life, it inspires the types of stories that I want to tell in my own creative writing endeavors, and it inspires me in my taste of not just manga, but other entertainment as well. So if you're on the fence about checking out a Taiyo Matsumoto manga, I definitely 100% recommend you do that. Start with Tech on Kinkreed, start with Ping Pong. Once you read those two things, you're going to be enamored with his art style, enamored with his storytelling, and I guarantee you that you're going to be as big a fan as Taiyo Matsumoto as I am. But until next time, folks, happy reading.
So thanks to Zach for helping in create this video, you know, for featuring on it and giving his personal opinions. You know, he's a really great friend of mine, so everything that he recommends to me, I definitely take on board, and so should you as well. So I will leave a link to his channel down below. If you aren't subscribed to him, then you definitely need to go and do that right away. We have a podcast together called Between the Shelves. I'm not sure if there's a new video out now, but we have recorded one. We recorded it months ago, and that will be out very, very soon. And yeah, if you enjoyed this video, then please let me know down below in the comments what your favorite Matsumoto work is. If you enjoy this type of series, then I'd be really interested to know which author you would like me to cover in the future. I've got some really, really great videos planned, so if you aren't subscribed to the channel already, then please do that. You know, thanks, I appreciate all of your support, and of course, I will catch you next time. Peace.